all the liberal institutions that arouse the frustration of this new conservative silent majority of ordinary Americans in the run-up to the Nixon election, none evoked more anger than the United States Supreme Court under Chief Justice Earl Warren. The Warren Court's rulings on matters of race challenged traditional social patterns in both the North and the South. In 1962, the case Engle versus Vitale, the court ruled that prayers in public schools were unconstitutional. In Roth versus the United States that same year, the court limited the authority of local governments to curb pornography. In Gideon versus Wainwright in 1963, the court found that felony defendants were entitled to a lawyer, regardless of their ability to pay. Two other cases supported this later, that I think just that next year. The court ruled that a defendant must be allowed access to a lawyer before questioning, and in the Miranda case, the court confirmed the obligation of authorities to inform a criminal suspect of his or her rights. You have the right to remain silent, etc. By 1968, the Warren Court had become the target of the silent majority of Americans who felt the United States had shifted too far towards helping the poor, the dispossessed, and the criminal at the expense of the middle class. Although Nixon later tried to shift the balance of power on the court by nominating justices when he could, the landmark Roe versus Wade case of 1973 happened on his watch. And of course, Roe versus Wade is struck down laws forbidding abortions in the first 3 months of pregnancy. After Nixon's 1968 election, a new youth culture that had been growing for some time emerged from the universities of sunny California and spread all across the nation. This new left counterculture movement was marked by protest, self-expression, opposition to Nixon's war draft, sex, drugs, and the music of Bob Dylan, the Beatles, the Rolling Stones, Led Zeppelin, Jefferson Airplane, the Grateful Dead, among many, many others. The new left challenged modern American society, attacking what it claimed were its banality, its hollowness, its artificiality, and its isolation from nature. As a part of this new left movement, Native American groups, Latinos, feminists, and gays staged protests during, especially 1968 and 1969, in a bid to claim the civil rights movement, or claim a movement of their own. And all of these groups made significant steps toward equality in American society in this era. This multi-headed new left movement and the so-called silent majority of ordinary Americans clashed repeatedly during Nixon's turbulent presidency. When Nixon invaded suspected North Vietnamese bases in the nations of Cambodia and Laos, it only fueled the anti-war protest movement already happening on college campuses. Over the course of 10 days in 1970, six college students were killed on campus by police and National Guard at universities in Ohio and Mississippi. In 1971, the New York Times began publishing excerpts from a secret study of the war in Vietnam prepared by the Defense Department during the era of President Lyndon Baines Johnson. These so-called Pentagon Papers had been leaked to the press, and they provided evidence that the government had been dishonest about its motives for American involvement in Vietnam and had exaggerated the actual winnability of the war. Coupled with reports of U.S. massacres of Vietnamese civilians overseas, drug addiction, racism, desertion, and mutiny among American soldiers, nearly two-thirds of Americans supported withdrawal from Vietnam by 1971. With the next presidential election in his sights, Nixon and his special assistant Henry Kissinger pushed hard for a peace agreement with the North Vietnamese. Though a temporary ceasefire was reached in the first days of 1973, these Paris Accords were weak, and by 1975, with America now firmly on the sidelines, Vietnam and Cambodia fell to brutal dictators. After 10 years of direct American military involvement, 57,000 Americans were dead, 300,000 more were injured, more than 1.2 million Vietnamese soldiers had been killed, and a beautiful land had been ravaged by war, leaving the people of Vietnam some of the most impoverished in the world. The United States, with its own economy in fits and starts back home, suffered a blow to its confidence with the Vietnam War, from which it did not soon recover. Although it was a political scandal that would ultimately destroy the Nixon presidency, the sudden slowdown of the booming post-war American economy finally began under his watch. The OPEC nations, or the Organization of Petroleum Exporting Countries in the Middle East, in a bid to claim power, began to use their oil both as an economic tool and a political weapon under the Nixon presidency. In the midst of the Yom Kippur War with Israel, they stopped selling oil to nations and supporting Israel, including temporarily the United States. Let me rephrase that. They stopped selling oil to nations who supported Israel, including temporarily the United States, which produced the first fuel shortages in America since the end of World War II. This energy crisis became a national preoccupation. And while Nixon talked about the need to achieve energy independence at home, he offered few concrete proposals. Of course, we still hear politicians talk about this idea. Other new challenges to American economic dominance include, finally, the recovery of Western Europe and Japan during the early 70s. By those early 70s, these allies were providing stiff competition to American firms in the sale of cars, steel, and electronics. But Nixon used a number of economic tactics to stave off rising prices and economic stagnation. It was clear that the high-wage, high-employment industrial economy that had been a central fact of life since the 1940s was gradually giving way to a new, more balanced international economic order. In the run-up to Nixon's 1972 campaign against the anti-war Democrat George McGovern, Nixon's effort to break into the Democratic National Committee's headquarters at the Watergate building in Washington, D.C., and its attempted cover-up permanently soured the public on the president. After Nixon's vice president, Spiro Agnew, resigned after separate criminal charges were levied against him, it quickly became clear that the popular leader of the House of Representatives, Gerald Ford, could step in to fill the role of president. The Supreme Court and the House of Representatives took actions to punish the president for his criminal involvement, and specifically the Watergate, the cover-up. Secret audio tapes that Nixon had recorded in his White House offices provided the smoking gun investigators and journalists were looking for. And so, with an impeachment movement organizing against him, President Richard Nixon simply threw up two peace signs, resigned the office of the president, and flew home to California. America endured through the stewardship presidency of Gerald Ford and then the challenges of the Jimmy Carter era, but it wasn't until the second election of Ronald Reagan in 1984, a full 11 years after Nixon's resignation, that America finally regained her confidence and outlasted the Soviet threat once and for all.